This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
Hey, this is Lauren Mary Kim, and I'm the stunt double for Ahsoka Tano in Clone Wars and the armorer in The Mandalorian. You're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. This is the way.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to another fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust, the galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. Before we get on with this week's discussion, Jay, where can we be found around the internet?
We can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
So this week, we are continuing a discussion that we started months ago. We reviewed issues 1 and 2 of Greg Pak's Darth Vader before quarantine started, or around the time quarantine started, and then Marvel quit putting out comics, and so we've never had an opportunity to pick up that discussion with issues 3 and 4. Well, Marvel's gotten back to publishing comics again on a very delayed and protracted schedule, but they're here, and so we're going to get into issues 3 and 4. And that'll leave us with issue 5, which will be the concluding issue for this story arc, which we'll get to in a month or two's time. But I am looking forward to getting into the discussion, especially after having read issue 4. It screamed Jay Krebs when I read it. Real quick, I want to get through the credits for this. As I mentioned, this story is written by Greg Pak, who also wrote Age of Rebellion and Star Wars 68 through 75. It was illustrated by Rafael Ionco. The letter was Joe Caramagna, colorist was Niraj Menon, cover artist was Inhook Lee, and the editors were Tom Groneman and Mark Panacea. And with those formalities out of the way, Jay, you want to go ahead and give us a summary of these two issues?
I would love to. And I love that you know me so well, can I just say? So here we go. Darth Vader's mission of revenge on those that stole his son from him continues. After discovering Padme's handmaiden and double, Sabé, he heads to Naboo, where Sabé says she had encrypted holo recordings from Padme's chambers on Coruscant. After arriving on Naboo, Vader and Sabé journey to the Naberi Lake House and discover Captain Typho and Captain Tanra standing guard. The three former bodyguards then take Vader and his forensics droid, ZC-7, to an underwater base where they spring a trap on Vader. They are the Amidalans, and they are devoted to avenging Padme Amidala's death. Before she died, Padme was last seen traveling to Mustafar, which is Vader's domain. Therefore, they believe Vader killed Padme. Vader survives Sabé, Typho, and Tanra's trap and becomes the first person to slay a Sando Aqua monster. However, when Vader arrives at Padme's tomb, he encounters more of the Amidalans, including Rick Olay, and more of Padme's handmaidens. Rick Olay and many of the other Amidalans are destroyed, but Vader spares the handmaidens as he makes his way into Padme's tomb, and the issue concludes. Oh my gosh. This is so good. Both of these issues were amazing.
You know, this story arc is not at all what I expected from a Darth Vader comic, and that's not a put down, or that's not a, I'm not disparaging in any way by saying that. It's a very interesting story. As soon as I saw those handmaidens show up and they were all lined up, and Vader had that flashback to seeing Queen Amidala standing behind her handmaiden on the steps, I was like, oh my God, Jay is in her own element right here.
Oh, you're not kidding.
Yeah. And so it was interesting to see how this worked out, because it was at the end of the first issue of this story where it was unclear who we were looking at, but it was, you know, Vader thought he saw Padme arrive, and it turned out to be Sabé. We learned that in the next issue. And she has been working towards avenging Padme's death, which is something that we actually learned at the end of the Queen's Peril novel written by E.K. Johnston. And so she is teaming up with Vader to get revenge for Padme and not really realizing who Vader is, that that's Anakin Skywalker. Of course, she knew Anakin and that Padme and Anakin had a past, but she hasn't been able to put all this together. And then it was in this third issue that answers the question that you and I had when we talked about the first two, is that really, would Sabé work with Vader? It doesn't matter what the circumstances were. And it was that all along, she and these other Amidalans believed that he was responsible for her death. So they set up this elaborate trap where Typho and Tanra led him down to this Gungan structure underwater, where they had this incredible depiction of the queen, and which Vader destroys. And then when he goes to review the security tapes, it is of the Amidalans swearing to get revenge for Padme Amidala. And then that's what sets off all events in motion. So that was very satisfying to me, because I have to admit, after that second issue, I was really struggling with accepting this idea that Sabé would work with Vader, because I don't believe for an instant Sabé believed that that was what Padme would want.
The way that they set this whole thing up was absolutely divine, I have to say, because there's, you know, there's so much going on with this whole thing. I mean, we're looking at Vader, you know, post Empire Strikes Back, but before Return of the Jedi, he's looking for these security recordings. He's really battling with a lot. He's got these ghosts of the past. He's facing a lot of his inner demons. I mean, and Luke's emergence just, I mean, it shook his tree, you know, big time anyways. And so just all of this stuff is just really kind of compounding down on Vader. And I feel like we also get a little bit of a flavor of Lords of the Sith in here too, even though that novel was set, what was it, like 8 years after the Clone Wars, when, mm-hmm. you know, but still Vader was dealing with a lot of the emotional turmoil that he had. And, you know, I just think that there's a lot of this going on where you see Vader destroying things that represent his former self. Like he, like you said, that shrine that the Gungans had, where it showed the peace ceremony where Anakin was actually in that depiction, mm-hmm. and he completely destroyed that. But yet there were other things that he left alone that were Padme's. And he was so out of place there. I mean, when he was standing in the field, you know, in the meadow where they had their picnic, and he's standing there as Vader, and all of these butterflies and everything are just flying around him. I mean, it's just, he's like a fish out of water, literally, in this whole thing. And it's also just very heart-wrenching in a way to see him like this, which is weird to say, being this horrible Lord of the Sith, but there's a lot going on.
Yeah, absolutely. It's an interesting journey that he's going on, because the first issue of the series opened with him reflecting on his encounter with Luke. And that was his whole trap to get Luke cornered on Cloud City and then to convince him to come over to the dark side with him. You know, he made that offer to Padme at the end of Revenge of the Sith, which was, you know, join me and we can rule the galaxy, we can make things how we want them to be. And then he basically makes the same offer to Luke, which is, you know, join me, we can rule the galaxy as father and son. And Luke rejects that offer as well. And so he sets off on this journey that Luke was stolen from him. When he, last time he saw Padme, she was pregnant. She was lying unconscious on that platform, but she got stolen away. He believed that she died and that their unborn child died. But now he comes to find out that Luke has survived. Someone's stolen him. Those people need to pay, because if they had interfered, he would have had Luke at his side all along. Luke would be weak. Luke would be strong. He would have learned all the things he needed to do, and things would be different now. But he set off on that journey, and it's evolved all along. As you were saying, he's everywhere he goes, he's seeing all of these moments he had with Padme. I put it in our notes as kind of like Anakin and Padme's greatest hits.
Yes.
Because, you know, they get there to the meadow and he sees images of him and Padme having that picnic on the blanket. And then when they get to the lake house, he remembers when they floated the piece of fruit across the table, and he made that remark about, if Obi-Wan saw me now, he'd be very grumpy. Mm-hmm. And you know, some of those other cheesy lines that came up. But so he's having all these recollections, and then he mows his way through the Sando Aquamonster, which, you know, was that giant one that tore the head off the gooberfish in The Phantom Menace. And then he plows through the Amidalans. He spares the handmaids, which we'll get to a second, but he's at the tomb, and now he's getting ready to investigate the tomb. But it's kind of like, well, that's not the mission you set off on, Vader. Right. The mission you initially departed on was to get revenge on all those that wronged you where Luke was concerned, but now you're headed into Padme's tomb. So what's this all about?
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, for me too, I feel like a lot of this resolves some of the questions that I always had in my mind, even going into one of my very favorite scenes in the entire original trilogy with Luke and Vader talking in Return of the Jedi on the bridge. And he's saying, there's still Anakin, you know, inside, you've just simply forgotten. And you can see the struggle within Vader. And, you know, with this comic, it's almost like that's now this so fresh, this experience of him going back to Naboo, that it changes that scene for me just even that much more. And mm-hmm. it gives it so much more gravity and so much more leverage, I feel like.
Right. And you know, it was one of the things that I noticed about this journey is that when he gets to the tomb, he walks in and the Jaipur snippet that he named for Padme when he was a boy is like sitting there. And the way they frame Vader's face, they're looking up at it, and with the shadows, they almost made him look sad.
Yes, I had this in my own notes as well.
I was just like, I didn't know you could make Vader look sad, but they kind of did there. And I'm really eager to see what he does in this tomb. You brought up earlier that there's this ongoing struggle that Vader has had, and you brought up Lords of the Sith, but it also came up in Charles Soule's run on Darth Vader, especially in the last arc when he constructed his palace on Mustafar. And the whole idea was it was going to allow him to open up a gateway to where I'm not exactly sure, but he believed that when he got through that, he was going to be able to bring Padme back, that he's going to be able to bring Padme back to life. And he had a whole lot of these similar flashbacks to his time with Padme while he was going through all of that. And especially when he's kind of walking through this force plane as this other force presence. And kind of at the end, he realized he couldn't get her back. And he closed that chapter on his life. And one of the last things he saw there on Mustafar was this outline of someone who he didn't know who it was, but it was, he was looking forward into his future. And it was Luke that he saw kind of putting an end to his dark path. And so now here he is in the present, having encountered Luke. It didn't go the way he wanted, and he started off on this mission to get this revenge to try and rectify this. And he still has a Luke in his future, but this turmoil over Padme is kind of clouding all of that.
Oh, that's just spectacular. And you know me, I'm always about the psychology behind, you know, what makes people tick. And Anakin/Vader is such a convoluted, complicated mess of a soul. And I just, it's a beautiful mess though. I love trying to figure him out. And it's, you know, and I think that a lot of the things that we're seeing, as you just mentioned too, it just proves how literally tormented his soul actually is.
Yeah. A couple other things about these two issues I wanted to ask you specifically, because just when I saw them, I was like, oh, I got to hear what Jay has to say. But first, they get to the lake house on Naboo, and they get ambushed by Typho and Tanra. And I knew right away one of them was going to be Typho, but I was surprised by Tanra. And of course, he had that relationship with Sabé in Queen's Peril. But what was your reaction to seeing him there?
Well, that's the first thing that I thought of too, was that, you know, we have a lot of these relationships between like Queen's Shadow and the Thrawn novel, because that's when they go back to Tatooine to try to, you know, find out what happened to Shmi. And then they end up free, you know, trying to free some of those slaves and that whole thing that was happening at the time. So yeah, I just thought that that was amazing that they were able to tie all that back in. And of course, Typho, the last time that he saw Padme was realistically at her funeral, but she was the last one to talk to him before she left for Mustafar. So they were all so incredibly loyal to her. And so it was awesome to see all of them just kind of coming back full circle to this. It's just, yeah, very extraordinary.
And then how about all the handmaidens showing up?
Oh my goodness. Yeah. Yeah. Cause that's like you said, Queen's Peril right there. And because you had all of them right there, and I've kind of got all of them written down. So we had Arete, who's the blonde, Rabe, Sashay, and you see her scars, and they even mention how she was tortured, you know, at the hands of these evil people. And then Dorme was there too, and we get that flashback of her just before Padme and Anakin go off to the lake house. So yeah. I love how they were all just kind of poised around them. They had their staffs, very Rey-like looking staffs almost. But yeah, that was awesome. I like how they mirrored the past and the present selves in the panels so that you could still, you know, relate them back and forth. But yet, yeah, that was very impressive. I was very impressed by all that.
It was an interesting blend because, you know, Arete and Rabe were part of that first group of Padawans. Mm-hmm. And then you had Sabé, who was part of that first group, but then she was kind of an attaché. She wasn't really working as a handmaiden for Padme in Queen's Peril. And Dorme at that point was in there. So you had this really neat transition of handmaidens there because it wasn't the full squad from either her queen days or her senator days, but it was an array of them. And there was some of the others that weren't there for whatever reason, you know, other lives elsewhere doing other things, and that's fine. But I remember seeing them. I was like, oh, that was clever, bringing them all back in, that the Amidalans expanded to include more than just Sabé in their midst. And I like the fact that they had, in fact, grown up, so to speak, that they had aged some, and that these were no longer teenagers. These were battle-hardened women that had other careers and done other things over the course of time. Did you think Vader was going to kill all of them?
I thought that it could happen, that it was very possible, because it's Vader. I mean, come on. You know, I mean, he sliced that one Mon Calamari just like right in half, and then he ends up killing Rick Olay and, you know, all of these other kinds of things. So, I mean, yeah, I thought that they definitely had a chance to peril at his hands, but you're right. They were very battle hardened and they've had a lot of years to become seasoned in their skills even more than they were.
Yeah. Did you make anything of the fact that while they were attacking him, he put an end to that by force choking all of them, which was the last thing he did to Padme? And he let Padme go, and then she ultimately ended up dying. But then with the handmaidens, he grabbed them all at once with a force choke, and they're all coughing, and then he drops them, and then he shoves them away with a force push.
Ooh, good call. I didn't even make that connection, honestly. I think that's ooh, you just gave me the chills.
Yeah, I'm really curious to see what's going to go on, because once he lets them go, Sabé comes crawling after him as he enters the temple, and you know, she's like, you know, you're not going to go in there. And he's like, yes, I am. Yeah. and then he starts to head in. And so we don't know what we're going to see there. But I'm really curious if they confront him again, if he will spare them again, or if he'll go ahead and kill them, if he's not trying to close a chapter in his story here and put the Padme Amidala behind him so that he can focus on Luke going forward. I'm not sure. I'm really curious to see where this goes.
Yeah, me too. And I've already got issue 5 on pre-order because this is really a fantastic series. Like you, I wasn't really sure what we were going to get into with all of this, and I wasn't sure how it was going to feel, but they've really done an impressive job with it. I do think, how do you feel about the fact that they were not only trying to avenge Padme's death, but also Anakin? And that's the last thing that actually Rick Olay says, is that it's for Anakin, you know, after he says it's for Padme too. That just blows my mind. So how do you feel about that?
It was interesting because, you know, they were able to put two and two together that Vader was involved in Padme's death because Mustafar is his domain, and that's the place where Padme went the last time she was seen alive. And so they figured out that Vader must have been responsible for her death. And so there was that trick. But it was not common knowledge that Anakin was there on Mustafar. I had to think about that for a little bit, because the world knows that, or the galaxy apparently knows, that Padme went to Mustafar And although she escaped from the planet, she barely escaped with her life and she died soon thereafter. And most people don't know that she actually had her children, that they were born before Padme passed away. But the galaxy doesn't know that Anakin fell to the dark side, became Darth Vader, and went there. And as I was reading it, my first reaction was, come on, make the leap. That this is Anakin. Make that leap. Then it occurred to me, it's like, no one knows that. No one knows what happened to Anakin during Order 66. Everyone just assumes he perished then. And if they were making that leap, that Vader had something to do with it as well. And I'm wondering what is leading Rick Oli to that conclusion. Exactly.
Yeah. I was trying to wrap my head around all of the different threads that could be, you know, leading Anakin, you know, back to being basically defended by all of these Amidalans so severely. But yeah, you're absolutely right. As far as Anakin being on Mustafar, and yeah, you would think that they would make the leap, but I don't know. It's crazy. Yeah. It's like the way you think about it. It's yeah.
Well, I wonder what would happen if they found out that Anakin was on Mustafar at the same time. You know, the other thing about that, I mean, Anakin is a hero of Naboo. I mean, he played a major role in the Battle of Naboo with the Trade Federation. You know, he was hiding in a fighter, then that ended up going up into space, and he's the one that destroyed the Trade Federation control ship. So I remember in Queen's Peril when Sabé is sneaking out of Tanra's room and R2-D2 had caught her in the act of doing it and had apparently informed Padme. And so Padme was talking to Sabé about this. You know, Padme was trying to be happy for her friend that she had this relationship going on in her life. But then the next time Sabé encounters R2, she says, you know, you little blue snitch, you know. But then later she kind of regrets it internally because R2-D2 is an honored hero of Naboo because he was part of the whole battle against the Trade Federation. Well, Anakin just as much, if not more so, in that case. And so I could see why they would be interested in avenging him, but it's kind of a faulty logic for them to say, oh, Vader must have done it, unless somehow they knew Anakin went to Mustafar and had reason to think that Vader was somehow involved in that. On a broader sense, I guess you could say it was symbolic that Vader represents this empire, and the empire ultimately resulted in Padme's death. And it was the Empire that killed the Jedi. Anakin was one of the Jedi, so they're avenging Anakin as well by taking out Vader, which I can see as more of a symbolic gesture than, as much as anything. But I don't know that they have enough information to make that direct conclusion.
Good thoughts. I like it. Yeah.
One other thing I wanted to note was that that Sando Aqua Monster, that Amidalans, you know, led by Sabé, Tanra and Typho, they managed to get to swallow Anakin. Because the whole thing, it was very similar to the way Kylo Ren ended up defeating a Zillow Beast in the Age of Resistance comics that came out at the end of last year. No one could defeat the Zillow Beast, and it was the god of these aliens that the First Order was trying to subjugate. And ultimately, the Empire had tried to do the same thing, but couldn't because the Zillow Beast showed up and kind of wrecked both armies. And then when the First Order shows up on this planet to do it, the Zillow Beast shows up and Kylo charges right into battle and ultimately defeats the Zillow Beast by getting swallowed and cutting his way out from the inside. And so I was like, well, like grandfather, like grandson here. It's there a very similar move. I was trying to figure out if that was something that was consciously done. Greg Pak didn't write Age of Resistance, but he wrote the series that came right before it, the Age of Rebellion series. And so if that seed had been planted long ago, or if this was purely a coincidence, I'd be curious to find that out. I don't know if that's been spoken on anywhere else, but that did stand out to me.
Well, they say that, you know, a lot of Star Wars is like poetry and it rhymes and there's a lot of repetitive kind of themes. So perhaps,
definitely. Well, was there anything else about these two issues that stood out to you?
Well, I mean, just in general, we've hit pretty much on just about everything. I just appreciate the way that there's so many different ties to things like we've mentioned, Queen's Peril. And for me, anyways, like I said, just the feels of even Lords of the Sith and even the Thrawn novel and, you know, and of course, you know, all the mirroring between, as you said, Anakin and Padme's greatest hits. But the one, you know, thing that you mentioned too with Vader looking sad. Like I said, I put that in my notes as well. I really tip my hat at the way that everything was drawn and illustrated, because the coloring, the shadowing, it really does kind of provide that glimpse into his thoughts and feelings that otherwise you would not get behind a mask like that. So, I mean, there's really, like I said at the very beginning, there's a lot going on in this, you know, these two issues of this comic that on first investigation, maybe, you know, you kind of gloss over, but yeah, there's a lot of depth here. Very profound.
Yeah. I have to admit, as I was reading through these two issues the first time, I wasn't enjoying it an awful lot, simply because it's like this story went completely off course from what Vader set out to do. Mm-hmm. But then, and especially because I was like, well, we're just getting all these Vader greatest hits. And we just did that in the Darth Vader comic where he constantly had all these memories of things that happened with Padme and whatever. But then when it started to involve in this, from the story of it, he's looking to get revenge for this on the people that stole Luke from him, that he started to come to the conclusion that Padme herself had a hand in this. And when he's seeing all these reminders of his past, he's coming closer and closer to his own conclusion himself. And I really wonder if that's what he's ultimately going to figure out in the fifth issue, that Padme willfully hid Luke from him. And especially when you consider like what we just talked about with the Afro audio drama and that hull recording that Padme left for the mortician, which is, you know, I'm with child. If I don't come back from this mission, I need you to do me a favor. So there's all this stuff in the background that I'm really afraid of what's going to happen to that tome and that statue of Padme that's outside in issue five.
And I'm also kind of morbidly curious to see what happens if he does get inside too. I mean, I'm not going to lie. Mm-hmm. You know, there is that bit of curiosity there too. But, you know, and getting back also full circle to what you asked about, do you know, the handmaidens, could they possibly perish here, you know, in the next issue? I think it's absolutely possible that they will, you know, just from our conversation, because the more I think about it too, I mean, they were willing to give themselves up and to die by setting off that underwater device, you know, and like Tanra and all of them were, because they were going to use that to avenge her death. So I think that it's very possible that they could possibly perish. I hope that they don't, but we'll see.
I was not expecting Rick Olie to show up, let alone die in this comic.
No,
I mean,
it was just,
I can't think, I'm sure he's been in other content. I don't know outside, you know, what's Legends now, but I can't think of how much content he's been in our current Star Wars continuity. It's not much, but you know, outside the Phantom Menace, you know, he shows up here and in a space of a few pages, he dies.
Right.
And so, you know, similarly with Typho, he's in the Clone Wars, but as you mentioned, the last time we really saw him chronologically, it was at Revenge of the Sith. Mm-hmm. And now here he is, and he could conceivably perish inside of three issues. And right. So I'm really curious to see what the ultimate conclusion is going to be here. Does Vader decide that he's angry with Padme and take it out on the handmaidens, or do they get away and put this quest for revenge behind them, seeing what it's done to Vader, if that somehow that gets out. But I'm much more eager for issue five than I was before.
Definitely, definitely. And one more observation too. One of the last things that he says, of course, when he sees the Jaipur snippet is, you know, we flash back to him saying, I made this. And then we get that little red box and he says, I made this. And all I could see is, yeah, you made this disaster. This was all you're doing, Anakin. I hate to tell you, but you did make this disaster.
So, yeah, that's a good point. That's a very good point.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that was a good discussion. And I'd like to thank you all for being here with us for our conversation regarding Darth Vader 3 and 4. And thank you all for listening to this episode of Podcast Stardust. I'd like to remind you that we are part of the RetroZap Podcast Network, and you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust over on RetroZap.com. You can also subscribe to Podcast Stardust on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, or wherever it is that you listen to your podcasts, including the RetroZap Podcast feed. If you've enjoyed the show, there are a few things you can do to help us grow. First, spread the word about Podcast Stardust on social media and make sure to tag us when you do. Also, please consider heading over to Apple Podcasts and leaving us a 5-star rating and a brief review about what it is that you like about the show. With that having been said, Jay, can you remind them where we are on social media and where they can also find us around the internet?
Sure. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. If you'd like to reach out to Dennis on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. We're also on Pinterest and YouTube, and if you'd like to email us your thoughts, you can do that at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. Have you read Darth Vader issues 3 and 4? We hope you have, because we just kind of spoiled it for you if you didn't. And it's been 5 months in the making, so yeah, we're really excited about it. So drop us a line, and if email's not your thing, you can always join us on Discord, where we can be found on the Discord room in the, let me start that over. You can always hit us up on Discord, where we are part of the RetroZap Discord room servers, and we're over there all the time talking Star Wars and you name it, just about everything else too. And you can also support us on TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. You can find all of our great show logo designs over there that were produced for us by Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi.
All right, that'll do it for episode 150 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.